Please do. Antra, I think we should start and let the other participants join.
Okay, sir. A very good evening to the distinguished guests, delegates, speakers, and the participants. I am Antra Kundu, Project Executive, South Asian Institute for Advanced Research and Development. On behalf of SIARD, my heartfelt gratitude to all the esteemed delegates for accepting the invitation and presiding over the first day of this 5 days national level faculty development program on research methodology and data science jointly organized by Sri Shikshayatan College and SIARD. Further making any delay, may I now request Ms. Jayati Dash, Associate Professor, Sri Shikshayatan College, to say a few words. Over to you, ma'am.
Very good evening to everybody. I'm Dr. Jayati Das, convener of Central Research Committee, Sri Shikshayatan College. Today, our principal is Dr. Aditi Dey, is unable to attend the inaugural session, but she has sent a message which I'm going to convey. So, greetings from Sri Shikshayatan College. It gives us immense pleasure to host this 5-day national level online faculty development program on research methodology and data science with South Asian Institute for Advanced Research and Development. It is my privilege to welcome Professor M. K. Sanyal, Dr. S. Mukhopadhyay, Professor A. Mulimari, Professor Aurobindo Bhandari, Professor Rajiv Kumar, Professor Jadav Kumar Das, Dr. Anirban Das, Dr. R. G. J. Bhai, Dr. S. Bhattacharya, and Dr. K. R. Ghosh, and all participants and organizers of this FDP. This program is certainly one of its kind, with eminent resource persons from different renowned universities around the country have graciously agreed to invest their valuable time and expertise to deliberate, discuss, and unravel myriad facets of a crucial academic field of study as data science. We are sure participants and all those interested in this will greatly benefit and add value to the existing knowledge base. We look forward to invigorating exchanges and rewarding engagements over the next 5 days. Wishing this endeavor all my best. Thank you, Dr. Aditi Dey, Principal, Sri Shikshayatan College. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for reading out loud Aditi ma'am's written message. We're hoping that ma'am could have joined, but it's okay. Hopefully next time she will join. And thank you so much for conveying her message to us. Thank you so much, ma'am. May I now request Dr. Bishu Choudhury, Chairperson SIARD, to say a few words.
Thank you, Antara. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Am I audible? Okay, thank you.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
First of all, thank you to you, and also I'm heartily conveyed my sincere thanks to the authority of Sri Shikshatan College, Kolkata, and also Professor Jayati Dash, Associate Professor, Department of Geography, and also the Chairperson of Research Cell of Sri Shikshatan College, for sharing their cooperations regarding these 5 days faculty development program on research methodology and data science also. So on behalf of our institutions, I would like to give my sincere thanks to all the resource persons, those who will join in this 5 days resource faculty development program from the different corners of India, and in the, also the participants, those who have joined from the different institutions for this 5 days event. First of all, I would like to share that from the very beginning of our institution, SIAD, and Sri Shikshatan College is one of the college of Kolkata, which work sincerely in collaboration in very dynamic way also. And in collaboration with SIAD, we have conducted several programs, academic initiatives, training, and conferences, workshops, webinars, etc., etc. And in this regard, whenever I approached them or any kind of appreciation they will come, we will definitely go for a very grand success on all these programs, events in the past also, and hope this event will also help to energize the mind of our as participants who will join here, who is basically is a participant here, and also the resource persons, those who have joined from the different corners, as I said, they are also a gem in their own field. So in this regard, we hope that this 5 days program will definitely help them to learn something new about the different application-based research methodology sector. And in future, we will promise you to deliver another events like this, as that it will help you to develop your research skill in further. So with this, once again, I thanks to all of you. And on behalf of SIAD, I heartily welcome to join in this event and I hope it will be a very successful event for us. Thank you, Antara, over to you.
Thank you, sir. Sir, has Shanal sir joined? Because I can't see the...
No, Shanal sir is in a meeting in Vikash Bhavan, in Education Directorate. So if it is possible for him, he will join within, otherwise within these days, he will join.
Okay, sir, then let's move to the technical session.
Yes.
Okay, sir. So for technical session, at first we have Dr. Shubrata Chattopadhyay. Dr. Shubrata Chattopadhyay is MSc, MBA, PhD from IIT ISM Dhanbad. Adept at innovative teaching practices, he is highly networked with the industry. He not only teaches but also practices, and his students do adore him for the same. He has contributed in more than 30 international journals and has published more than 23 papers and in seminars and conferences. Besides, he has authored 3 books on competition in asset management, transport management, and value and ethics for engineers and managers. He is on editorial board of 5 international journals and NBSC Government of India recognized faculty on entrepreneurship and a mentor to startups. He is a mentor of change in the Atal Innovation Mission of Government of India and has been conferred the prestigious Certified Management Teacher by MTC Global for his innovative and dedicated teaching and mentoring in 2015. Also, he has successfully chaired and invited as keynote speaker in several national and international conferences in South Asia. Dr. Shubrata Chattopadhyay has been awarded and recognized as the Outstanding Higher Education Leader of the Year by SOE Global Education Awards in 2014 and recognized by NFED for his contribution to mentoring startups, teaching and research for 2 consecutive years, 2013 and 2014. He was conferred the prestigious MTC Global Top Thinkers Award in September 2015 and Mentor of the Year by HRD India in June 2019. He is associated as life member with ISTD, CMA, PRSI, NIPM, NHRD, NFED, ISABS, and does mentoring and consulting for various organizations. Today, he'll be speaking on a case-based research. Over to you, sir, Dr. Shubrata Chattopadhyay.
Yeah, very good evening. I hope I am audible. Am I?
Yes, it's just a little bit echo, sir, but you are audible, sir.
Okay. I think it's better now, is it? So very
yes,
good
sir.
Evening to yeah, very good evening to Syed, the chairman of Syed, for giving me this opportunity to Antara Madam and Jayati Das Madam, to all at Sri Shikshartan College, right? So you know, this is the topic that I've selected is a very interesting and you know, upcoming topic. Now, the thing is that we will be spending, you know, next 45 minutes to 1 hour on case-based research, right? Now, as I start, what is a case? So let us understand, and you know, how to write a case study. Why is a case study relevant? For whom is it relevant? Is it for the students? Is it for the industry? Is it for the researchers? To whom does the case study address? So, you know, I have written a couple of case studies, and you know, in the year 2019, I went to a conference at BIMTEC Noida, wherein, surprisingly, or you know, otherwise, as you say, I got the best case award by the UK Case Center. Okay, and this case center award was for my case of Vamomo. So Vamomo is, you know, a Kolkata-based company, right? And they actually started off with organizing the Momo, which was not there. Today, you know, in the food sector, we have a number of wows, right? It is not only Wow Momo, we also have Wow Puchka that is also available. Maybe, you know, somebody or the other, I'll be writing a case study on that. But, you know, when we started writing cases, so I've written a couple of cases, right? Like Wow Momo I have written, then, you know, for Virtual Infocom, which happens to be, you know, one of my very close friend and brother's company, Arjit Bhattacharya. So I've written a case for them. So I was with MBI, and then, you know, I have written a case on innovative teaching pedagogy, and, you know, how and what type of teaching, outcome-based teaching, what would be the components of outcome-based teaching. So we did, you know, a thorough research and came up with a case which was actually published by a very reputed journal, right? So, you know, a couple of case studies. So before we start, can I please share my screen? Is it possible? I'm just sharing my screen, okay?
Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
Just a minute. Is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Is it visible? Can you?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, I think it's visible, right? Okay, great. So basically, you know, I'll be first of all introducing you to case study as a pedagogy for teaching. So, you know, for researchers, for faculty, right, this case-based teaching is very important. Why? Because, you know, it gives you a practical, you know, oriented approach towards, you know, understanding a particular case. Okay, so what is a case? Is it a story? Is it an actual situation? Or or a vivid description of a situation, or is a case a hypothetical situation? Is it a research outcome? Is it about problems that have been solved and which give counterintuitive understanding? So let us understand that what is the purpose of case? What is the objective of the case study? So basically, a case study actually allows the students and researchers to apply the concepts. So whatever, you know, chapters that they are reading, on a practical basis, applying that is enabled by a case study. So you can actually give, like we give examples, we give, you know, small case lists or situations. So case study is basically, you know, in a broader sense, it gives you a practical approach as to how the thing was, and actually it leads you to understand the case from different dimensions given that particular context. So basically, in one way, it can be said that it is a simulation of the actual thing that is there. So hence, you know, a case study is a very practical oriented, you know, study, and a research is required on the same. So it actually helps in focusing on internalization rather than knowledge. So many a times we see that research students, and also, you know, students from different fields, they have knowledge, but then when it comes to application, they falter. So case study actually helps to focus on internalization. So, you know, whatever they learn, if they learn with the case study, then the remembrance is much higher. So they can relate. Actually, when they act after their studies, when they go out to the field, they can actually relate that this was a case, this was a chapter, right? This is what we had studied, and, you know, utilize that in their practical field of work. So case study is a process of approaching a problem, but it's a beginning and not the end. Okay. I hope the screen is moving. Just a minute. Let me check.
Sir, if it is possible, please share full screen.
Okay. Okay, I'll do that. Just a minute. The full screen tab is F5, right? Is it coming?
No, sir.
Just a minute.
Sir, it may be there in slideshow, or you can go for F5 key.
Just a minute.
F5 key.
Actually, you know, it's not activated over here for some reason, maybe.
Sir, no problem. Carry on. It's all good.
Yeah, actually, you know, it's not a Windows platform. It's a Linux platform, right? So maybe, you know, for that reason, it's not coming. But I hope the slides are changing, right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sure.
Okay, great. So, you know, I discussed about the objectives of case study. Now, let us understand that under what conditions does a case become optimal? So why do we write a case? For whom do we write a case? Where there is contextual ambiguity, that means that there is some sort of an ambiguous sense in the context, and that is why we are writing the case study. Many do think that case study is basically, you know, a decision-making dilemma. There is also another understanding that a case study does not have a unique solution, or the otherwise, that many a times researchers and thinkers and students, they think that case study must have a solution. application of concepts. So case study, as I said, this is a prime thing that, you know, it helps application of concepts, and it actually results in generalizations from one. So you study a particular case-based research, and from there you can do inductive reasoning. Can there be a theoretical basis to the cases? Can there be emphasis on analysis or making choices? So what are the alternatives? So when we talk about case-based research, right, the other alternatives can be a lecture method of teaching, or, you know, a project work, or self-learning, or on-the-job learning, assignments, etc. So moving on. Just a minute. The slide is not changing. So, you know, in a case study, there are several limitations as well. Like, the learning is student dependent, and hence the quality of learning would vary significantly across the student set. Now, in case study, you know, a group-based learning is important, and pre-class preparation for the participants is, again, you know, a very, very important. It has to be sound, otherwise the case discussion cannot happen. Now, the case study can be, you know, different types of case studies can be there, right? Like, you know, you are writing a teaching case, or you are writing a case for, you know, the different corporates, okay? Or you are writing it for, you know, different researchers, okay? So you need to understand that, you know, what type of case study are you writing, and for whom you are writing, and what is the scope of writing the case study, okay? So let me, you know, share with you that, you know, what are the things that one should look into when, you know, one writes a case study, right? Just a minute. So what are the things, and how can we actually write a case study, right? So let me share with you, you know, my experience. So when we start off with a case study, and this I have seen, you know, in several Scopus indexed case journals, Emerdal case journals, what is very important is that when I'm writing the case study, I have to create the initial drama or the impact that has to be there. Now, unless, you know, it creates an instant impact with the reader may not be able to relate or to go ahead with the case. So it is very important to create an instant impact with the reader. Now, there may be, you know, another, you know, a thing. One may think that a case study is based on secondary research. Now, that is not the case. We use secondary data as well as primary data. So when you are writing a case study for a particular company, right, it is also a very good branding exercise for the organization. Say, for example, if I want to write a case study on Syed, and, you know, if we can include, you know, how it started, what are the things that went through, and write a case, do a research, and also see that which are the other organizations which are there, and see how, you know, the positioning of this organization vis-a-vis other global organizations are there. So I need to understand, you know, for what purpose am I writing the case study? For any particular organization or institution, one can write, you know, different case studies, and a case study can be having different types of focus. It can be from the marketing point of view, it can be from the finance point of view, it can be from the technical point of view, it can be from the HR point of view, operations point of view, right? So I need to understand that, you know, what is my core area and what is the problem? What is the problem that I'm going to address? Now, the thing is that as I go on interacting with people or do a research to find out that what is the problem or what are the problems and how this can be solved, right? So there can be, you know, different types of solutions. Now, which of these solutions would be feasible? I need to understand that. Now, again, when I say feasibility, it talks about that, am I taking an optimistic decision? Or am I going for a pessimistic decision? Or I am going in the middle of the road? So what type of decisional approach that I am going to address with the case study, that is very important. So, you know, writing a case study, as I said, you know, initially you have to create a lot of impact. You have to, you know, narrate that how they started, from when they started, and, you know, how their growth over the years has come. And then, you know, you can start like this, like, you know, the founders of the organization were having a cup of coffee and, you know, sitting in a shopping mall, and suddenly, you know, they thought that let us do a search in the history and find out that from the point we started till now, what has been our journey so far and what is the road ahead. It can be such that, you know, one is the founders, maybe, you know, they just visited a particular outlet or a particular store, or, you know, may have overheard a decision, a discussion going on, right? And that actually tinkered the thought that, well, can we solve this issue? So the thing is that the protagonist meaning, you know, the person who is, you know, actually narrating the case, right? The protagonist, you know, how you are putting the protagonist in the case, that is very important. And also, it is very important that any case that you are deriving, right, it has to be data driven. So data is fundamental, you know, for any case, because it doesn't mean that, you know, theoretical cases are not there. And, you know, there was one point of time when people used to write, you know, case studies of 70 pages, 80 pages and so on. Right. But, you know, things are fundamentally changing. And, you know, these days, you know, even the top publishers are saying that the case study should be limited to around eight pages or 10 pages. Right. So the thing is that, you know, the how to, you know, limit and restrict and at the same time create a lot of impact through a case study, that is very important. Okay. And what would be the flow for your case study? Because when I'm going through a particular case study, right, what are the analytical perspectives that are there? How would the reader relate to, you know, whatever they have learned and apply it in the case study? That is very important. So, you know, one of the things which I used to do is that, and I still do, is that, you know, I write a particular case, and before publishing, right, I take it to my class. So, you know, a case study being taken to a class so as to understand that what are the different types of questions that are coming in. And also, you know, it is important that, you know, in some of the cases, what we have done is we have prepared questionnaire and got it filled by, you know, the people who are, for whom we are writing the case study. Maybe, you know, it can be like I'm writing a case study on how an organization has handled different types of grievance. So grievance redressal. So what is the organizational capability and excellence in handling different types of grievance that exists in an organization? So herein, I need to understand that what would be my sample and from where would I collect the data? Because this data collection is very important. Now, if I am doing my study on a particular state or a particular region, right, how will I reach out to these people? Will I get access? Given that, you know, if I am taking the data across, you know, different levels of employees, can I get access and can I get the right data? Now, another very important thing which I want to mention over here is that when you are writing the case study, say for example, you are starting to write a particular case study, doing a case-based research, right? You will be doing the case for a particular organization. Now, the thing is, you need to understand that why would the organization allow you or permit you to write a case study for them? What is it in for them? So if you go to, you know, Harvard case study or European case center or UK case center, right, you will find case studies of different companies there. So, you know, you need to understand and explain to the stakeholders, to the, you know, the decision maker, so to say, that when you are writing the case study, it is actually a good branding exercise for the organization that you are writing. And at the same time, this provides you with a field wherein you can collaborate for research, for practical applied research with the organization. So one of the strategies which I would suggest you may take it as a tip from here, is that one of the, you know, top management whom you are talking and discussing, right, it's very easy if you can involve him or her as a writer of the case. So maybe, you know, two or three of you, so maybe two of you are writing a case, the third author maybe, you know, the person from the organization. And that gives a lot of credibility also, right, to the case that, you know, someone who is into the top management of the organization is also one of the writers of the case. And it also gives you a lot of, you know, leverage on gathering data and enables you to collect data in time and, you know, do the proper analysis for the research. Now, another thing which is very important is that a case study, you know, especially if it's a teaching case, it's not only the case study that you write, right? You also need to have a teaching note. So a case study, you know, has a teaching note also. And this teaching note would be that, say, for example, if you are delivering that case to a particular audience, what would be the flow? What are the things that the audience need to do? What are the things that your students may be needing to do, right? Or, you know, maybe your case is being taught in a particular business school or, you know, a particular engineering college. Then what are the, you know, things, what are the objectives and, you know, how would the flow be? What are the things that they need to understand? How would you manage maybe, you know, the 45 minutes or 1 hour of the session? So, you know, the teaching note would contain all that. So what would be the questions that you would ask in the when you are delivering the session? So there are numerous ways of, you know, delivering a case study. I will not go into that. I'll just, you know, keep it that what are the things that you should do in writing the case. So case study and a teaching note is very important. Now, one of the, you know, major limitations of a case study, I would say, is that if you are starting to write your case, maybe in 2021, right, you may take maybe, you know, 6 months to 1 year time to, you know, write the full case. Now, When you are giving it to a publisher, let me tell you, right? It takes around 1.5 to 2 years to publish the case. Now, having understood that, see, a case study is, you know, about a situation about the company, or it tells you everything about the company at that particular time. Now, the pace at which the world is moving, the pace at which, you know, the research is progressing. Say 2021, you start writing the case, you finish the case writing in 2022, right? And you submit to a particular case-based journal, and then, you know, after numerous revisions, etc., the case is published in 2024. The students may be reading that case, or, you know, you may be running that particular case maybe in 2025 or 2026, right? And given, you know, the technological progress that is happening, your case study may be, you know, redundant by then. So what would you do, right? So the thing is that when you are selecting the topic of the research, it should be such that it should have its relevance in the years to come, right? So at least, you know, after it gets published, maybe, you know, at least 10 years, it has some sort of a relevance. And maybe you have to go for a revised case based on the, you know, case that you have written, and, you know, at a later point of time, you go for, you know, updating the things and then publish and have a different scope for publication. Right? So that in a nutshell is about, you know, case-based research and how do you go about doing a case-based research and writing a case study, right? How do you, you know, organize the case? How do you interact with the, you know, people who matter, right? The protagonist. And how do you, you know, arrange that in a particular form? So I'll just, you know, share with you some of the, you know, methodology that we adopted in when we had written the case studies. So when we were writing about innovative teaching pedagogies that was practiced in a particular business school, so, you know, in here it was MDI Murshidabad. So what we did is, you know, two of us marketing faculty, we adopted different techniques of, you know, the teaching learning process, and wanted to see that what is the impact of that particular thing. So, you know, beyond books, what are the, you know, different things by which the students can learn? So one of the things that we did was about, you know, book presentations. So they were given, you know, different book titles, and they presented that. Now they were asked that how they can relate that to their, you know, subject books. Does it have any sort of relevance? So which subject? So what happens is that the application, see, the book is written for a different purpose. Now the subject, the chapter is written for a different purpose, but the student is able to apply the knowledge to, you know, the storybook and link the subject and the storybook. So there may be, you know, numerous applications. So this was one of the ways that we did. The other was, you know, with different movies we had experimented that what were the management learnings from the different movies. And this actually was also, you know, how it got related. The movies that they saw and what were the learnings from the different subjects and how they could relate to it. And there were, you know, external judges who actually evaluated their learning process. The third method that we adopted was about, you know, the learnings from the different newspapers, then, you know, observing the different news channels, media, etc. Right? Okay. Mr. Jaiswal, you are writing, sir, if you can share with us any practical case which you did in the recent time. So I'm talking about practical case which I did in the recent time. This was about MDI, right? In WAMOMO also I'm going to share with you. Is that fine, Samir? Mr. Samir, is that fine?
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So, you know, what was the outcome? What was the objective of writing this particular case study, this different activities that we did? So, you know, we try to understand that is the knowledge level increasing and is the performance in the campus interviews. So outcome-based learning, is that coming up? So we have seen that, you know, this innovative teaching pedagogy that we adopted, that has actually resulted in greater or better outcomes for the students. Now, when we wrote the WAMOMO case, we started with a dilemma. So it is very, you know, one way of starting writing a case, as we did for WAMOMO, is first of all, you know, start with, you know, different types of questions which goes on in the protagonist's mind. Now, if you know something about, you know, WAMOMO founders, this guy is Sagar Dariani, Vinod Homagai, right? They were actually students of Sensibles. And, you know, they had different options in their career. So the first, you know, dilemma was that why should we go for entrepreneurship rather than go for, you know, what traditional way others do, like going for chartered accountancy or going for MBA, right? Why become an entrepreneur? And that too, they were coming from middle class family. So they had to make a career choice. The second is that there was an opportunity which was open in front of them. The opportunity was, so they experimented with, you know, different things, different lines of business. So they wanted to be into the food business, but then what happened is Vinod, you know, has his roots in Nepal, and, you know, he you know, could cook momos. So what they did is that after their college hours, when they were in hostel, they experimented with different recipes. And that's how they thought that let us start off with momo, because, you know, there are retail outlets which are there, but then no particular brand was there. So they decided to start with that. And how did they actually, you know, create awareness? They created awareness by, you know, making the people sample their products. So they approached, you know, different retailers, and what happened is that when they approached Spencer's, so Spencer's had given them, you know, a small space to set up a stall. And what Sagar and Vinod used to do is that they used to, you know, cut a particular momo into two or three parts and ask the, you know, customers, ask the people, right, to sample that. That was the start. And, you know, after they sampled, they would ask for an honest feedback, and they asked that, would you love to take, you know, a packet of momo for your family? So that's how, you know, they actually built up the market. So, you know, along with the IDA, that is the awareness, information, desire, and action. So along with the IDA, see, when you are writing the case, you have to create an impactful story. So the storyline, so I was basically narrating the story. So, you know, after they started, then the important challenge was that how to expand, how to get funding, who would be funding, and would they actually restrict themselves to Kolkata or West Bengal? The other important point for consideration was that momo was a perishable item. And let me tell you, in my different conversations, what happened is I asked them to open up a store, an outlet rather, at MDI. So MDI was in Murshidabad, and in Murshidabad, Wa Momo was not present at that point of time. So, what they said is that, sir, it would not make sense, to transport the momos, from Kolkata to Murshidabad. Doesn't make any sense. So now they thought that, okay, this is what the challenge is. Let us do something. Can we increase the life of a momo? So that was another challenge for them. Now the dilemma was, would prefer, people want delicious fresh food. Would they want, momos, maybe which were prepared 3 months back? Can they actually retain the same taste? Because that would impact their brand name. So they came up, with momos which had a longer life. Okay, so today you would find Wa momos which you can use for like frozen foods, you can use in a tenure of 6 months. So that was another, thing. The third thing was that they thought that, okay, our business is increasing. Now what? So would we only restrict to momos and, capitalize on momos only? Because that is basically our strength area. So then they thought that, okay, momo is basically a food of the hills, but then we can actually diversify to Wow China, Chinese foods. Are you understanding, Samir? Okay, is it,
yes, sir.
Is it making sense for all of you, right? So then came the question that should they go for Wow China along with Wow Momo? That was another crucial decision that they had to take. Then what happened is that they launched Wow China. But if you remember, Wow China was launched around 2019, the second half of 2019. And after that, there was a pandemic. And because there was a pandemic, the challenge for them as a company was how to retain the employees, because most of the people were not, venturing out, and people were not buying food from outside. They were very skeptical. People were very skeptical. People were very afraid, quite naturally, because of this pandemic. Now, the thing is, you must be knowing that many companies have actually downsized their people. Many people lost jobs. Many people got lesser salary. So the problem for these guys, Sagar and Vinod, was how to sustain these people. And what they did is that since the momos was not selling, what they did is they came up with grocery. Okay, so imagine selling momos to now becoming a big basket of grocers. So grocery, foods, etc., they came up with that particular business. So this is a very, very important lesson that, how do you move and how do you scale up and how do you scale out? So this case can be taught, or it can be written from the entrepreneurial perspective, that how the entrepreneurs should shape up their journey from scaling up to scaling out. Or it can be that it can be even for a session on, you know, how do you motivate yourself? How do you transform yourself? Okay, so you know, transformation, organizational transformation, and leadership. So it can be used for that as well. So when you are writing a particular case, right, you need to understand that which are the you know, areas of research that you are writing your case for. Is it your domain of knowledge? Is it you know, something which you would be able to replicate your thoughts on your research? How would you collect the data? Okay, and where and when would you collect all the relevant data, and how would you present that? Okay, because when you are writing a particular case, right, the theory part of the case, the learnings from the case, then the analysis of the case, and if you are also you know, writing a case for positioning, say for example, then you have to also understand that, you know, you write about that particular company, then the other companies, where they are placed, and so on. Like, you know, one of the cases you know, which I researched on, and you know, also I taught in the class, is about sustainability of the different vehicles. Okay, so the petrol and diesel vehicles, you are already seeing that it is gradually being replaced by electric vehicles. So this is a sector which would undergo a radical transformation, both in the two-wheeler as well as the four-wheeler. And you have seen that you know, Ola has started in a big way manufacturing electric bikes. So you know, this is a case wherein a company, see, Ola was basically into, you know, app-based logistics services, right? So they actually went back and started manufacturing. So as organizations do this, it is also important for us researchers to understand the very rationale of doing so, and you know, tell to the world and tell to the researchers and the students that why and for what reason the companies or organizations are doing so. Is it relevant? Is it sustainable? Can it deliver value? Would it add to their core competence? Now, we are in such a time wherein, you know, organizations' mission, vision, etc., right, which was there, you know, for 2 years, 5 years, 10 years down the line, the time is being shortened. And given this time, in this such a situation, one needs to understand that how and why organizations are actually doing these things. Okay, and base the case on the same. So I think I have given you know, a vivid description about how to approach a case study, how to write a case study, what are the things that one should consider while writing a case study, and what is the relevance of the case study, and you know, how does it create an impact in the minds of the readers, and how do you publish case studies. So that in a nutshell is what you know, I had to cover. If you have any questions, I think Mr. Jaiswal, have I been able to explain to you?
Yes, sir. Actually, I joined a little late, sir. So I'm okay. Not able to, you know.
So now, having listened to the story, I think you could relate, right?
Yeah, sir, I can.
great. Yeah, I can. Thank you so much. So if we have any other questions, you know, or anything that you want to, I think I covered, you know, in this short time, I covered more or less about, you know, how do you write a research paper? How do you conduct a case-based research based on the researches that we have done? And how can you publish that particular? Very important is publishing, right? For us research scholars, you know, publishing is very important, right? Unfortunately, you know, we do, you know, a lot of you know, research into writing papers, but then, you know, case-based papers are, you know, relatively less. And this is one area, let me tell you, you don't need too much of, you know, mathematical or statistical analysis, but then, you know, you can actually, if you are a good storyteller, if you are a good, you know, in analytical skills, and you can, if you can present it in a suitable form, right, your paper would get published. Thank you so much.
If any other participants have any question, you may ask those. You can write in the chat box as well.
Yeah.
Well, sir, I don't think there's any further question raised. You have.
Do we get the recordings of this session?
Yes, sir. We have recordings, sir.
Yeah. You will share with us in the group or something.
We will
provide the YouTube link. There you may get all the recordings.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Yeah.
But I hope you know, the session has made you understand something about the basic nuances of case-based research and how do you write the case-based research. Okay.
Yes, sir. Actually, it is very informative. Right now, I am writing a case study only. So, मेरे लिए तो बहुत ही अच्छा था ये.
Thank you so
much. बहुत धन्यवाद सर.
Thank you so much. If you want to, you know, touch base, you know, you can contact Syed. The sir is there, or Vishay sir is there, right? You can also contact madam, right? And I can help you.
Anytime.
You know, publish the case, and we can go ahead with a good case study presentation. Yeah.
Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah.
Well, I think there's no further question raised. So I am pretty sure that you have completed everything covered in such short span of time. It was wonderful, sir, that you have demonstrated such important topics so wonderfully. Thank you so much, sir.
Thanks for the opportunity, right? I'm sure I have made some justice to the opportunity given by the chairman, sir.
Yes.
Professor Rai Choudhury. I don't know whether sir is there.
Yes, sir. He is there, sir.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Now we have a presentation from Dr. Kira Dash Ghosh. Dr. Kira Dash Ghosh is a postgraduate in commerce from University of Calcutta, West Bengal, and has acquired MPhil and PhD. In addition to her academic background, she was conferred with a senior diploma in music and Visharad in classical dance. She is presently working with Amity University as assistant director as well as head of the Department of Commerce and Finance. She has 17 years of teaching experiences with various management and general education institutions. Her research areas are microfinance and microenterprises, financial management, and stock markets. She has 2 UGC projects, 28 research publications, and 2 books to her credit till date. Today, she will be speaking on research process and methods of data collection. Over to you, ma'am.
Good evening, all. Am I audible, Antara?
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Audible.
Good evening, sir. Good evening, all the participants. Again, thanks to Dr. Biswajit Rai Choudhury for inviting me for this session, and Antara, who is the student of mine and doing now PhD from this prestigious institute. And I'm welcoming to all of you, as you are already in the very informative research schedule, where we will discuss from the very basic research program, because the it's based on the research methodology, as well as I'll show you that the way of data collection. And I'll present that different types of data analysis too. So I'll start my presentation. I'll share the screen. Antara, I'll be able to share my screen?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so I'll show my presentation also. Sure. In between, if you have any question, please write it in chat box. And I hope you can unmute yourself at the end of the session too. Is it visible?
Yes, ma'am, it is visible.
Okay, so I'll start from the very basic of business research process and data collection, as it is today is the first day of the session. So what is research process? Research means the re-identification of the process, whatever you want to do. So there are six steps of research. One is the definition of the problem, that what you want to search. Second one, the literature review. That means whatever you want to do, for that you have to complete your literature, the previous literature that will substantiate your identification. And then selection of research design, subjects and data collection techniques. That is also the third method of this type of research. Then you have to collect the data, data gathering. Then next one is data processing and analysis, and implication and recommendations of your research. So basically, when we want to go for a new study, a new research, we need to remember these six basic steps of analysis. Now, what is the definition of problem? You know that every day we are facing loads of problems. So what is the research problem or research authenticated problem? When we decide to write one paper, or when we decide our PhD topic, then at the first, very first, we need to keep our knowledge that what should be the definition of our research title. Describe the broader context, because at the initial period of time, you cannot finalize your topic, because you don't know whatever is coming in the literature review. So you have to finalize a broader background of this your research arena. Now, next step, you need to finalize the objectives or the purpose of this research. That why you want to do, where is the research gap, where the other authors stopped, and you want to start from there. It's a research. It's the re means again, you have to start the research where the previous author stopped. Inform reader about the scope of the study, including defining any terms, limitations or restrictions, and reduces potential criticism. Whenever we are going for any objective or subjective purpose, definitely we'll get some potential criticism. So you have to inform the reader that about the scope of the study, what you want to do, including defining any terms, limitations and restrictions. Your limitations also for the research paper you have to express, and state the hypothesis for your research work.
Can you just make it the full screen?
Is it not the full screen, Antara?
No, ma'am. It's not full screen, ma'am. Are you in the first slide yet? Because the slides are not changing even. It's the same slide. The number one slide we can
it's showing see. The number one slide?
Yes, okay. Ma'am.
Just a minute. Is this changing, Antara, now?
Now we can see literature review, but I don't know next time when we when you will change, if it's like
is it a full screen?
No, ma'am, not yet.
Ma'am, please click on the enable editing button, then we can do. Yeah.
I'm sorry. Yes. Yeah. So I'll start again from the six steps. Is it okay now?
Ma'am, you have stopped sharing your screen. Ma'am, can you just reshare it?
Yes, just a minute. Is this okay now?
Yes, we can see your presentation.
Ma'am, slides are not visible.
Yes, ma'am. It's I can see the third slide.
problem definition, is that visible?
Yes, ma'am. 6 steps of research. The slide name.
Then literature review. I have started with literature review. Is that?
Okay, no, ma'am. I can see the third slide, which states 6 steps of research. Yes, now I can see literature review.
Is that visible, Antara, literature review?
Ma'am, it's visible, but it's not the full screen, ma'am. Sometimes it happens, ma'am, actually.
Yes, from my side, it is full screen only. Share my presentation with you so that you can also operate, that everybody can see to that. Do you think that will help?
Actually, ma'am, because of the heavy rain, my network connection is very poor right now.
Exactly, it is same here. But the participants, if they cannot see, then what is the utility of this presentation? Let me try once more again. Please bear with me because of the network issue of this heavy rainfall. Just a minute. I'll share it once again if it is visible to all of you. Is that okay or it's still not coming?
No, ma'am, it's not the slide. It's not the full screen. Ma'am, you carry on because we can see the slide.
Because I will share the whole presentation if it is visible to all. I'll share the whole presentation to you all. Otherwise, I can share it with you, any desired one. I can mail it to you if you can operate. Okay, so I'll start with the literature review portion. So literature review is the very base of any research orientation.
Sorry to interrupt you again. It's 6 steps of research, ma'am. Can you just go to the literature review slide? Yes, ma'am. Now it's the literature review.
Is that literature review?
Yes, ma'am.
So it's a theoretical rationale of problem being studied. What research has been done and how it relates to our problem. Whenever we are starting with any one specific problem, we need to go to the back and we need to finalize the the base work or the rationale of problem being studied. Helpful to divide the literature into subtopics for ease of reading. When we are concentrating on our particular research work, we need to divide our literature into subtopics, which will be easier for our then data collection process as well as to form our chapter of thesis 2. Quality of literature should be assessed. We should not depend on the literature which is coming through the net search. So we have to go for the very authenticated sources of literature and we need to study this one. Be sure to include well-respected individual in the research area if they exist. So if you are concentrating on a particular research area, who are the Nobel author for this? You need to search for that. Now, selection of research design. Is it changing, Antara?
No, ma'am.
Selection of research design, I have changed the next slide. It's not changing.
No, ma'am. Ma'am, see, actually you are like, you can see the full slide, right? Full screen, you are doing the slideshow, but we are unable to see that. So just let's do one thing. You just stop the slideshow and yourself change the slides from the left side. I guess
that will be too smaller. But I don't know why it is not going on properly. Maybe some network issue. So is it visible literature review now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, selection of research design, is that visible?
Yes, ma'am, it's visible. It's
okay,
visible.
So I'll increase this one. I think it's better. Selection of research design. The research design, the next step is research design. You have to design and indicate the steps that we'll need to take and the sequence it will occur. So not only the research or the thought process, you have to finalize the particular design, the way you want to carry your research work. Each design can rely on one or more data collection technique. There are different data collection techniques that I will discuss later on. So each design can rely on one or more data collection technique. Access, reliability, and validity. Definitely, you have to go through your access, that which one is reliable and which one is valid till the end of your research process. Critical consideration in determining methodology in the selection of subject. The next step is, after the selection of research design, you have to finalize your methodology. The methodology means in which method you want to continue your research problem. That is the methodology. Next step is data gathering. So data gathering means how to collect your relevant data. Data gathering must be pre-tested, that the researcher or the students, they are getting data from these authenticated sources. So it must be pre-tested one. Design the sampling scheme. I will discuss sampling in the later on period, that what is sampling and how you have to manage with the sampling. You have to finalize the sampling scheme of your research methodology. And your questionnaire must be coded. Then you need to prepare your questionnaires, that before the data collection, if the questionnaire or the schedule is not prepared with you, then how come you will ask the primary data? So the data sheet or the questionnaires must be ready with you all. Data processing and analysis. So what is the data processing and analysis? If I start from the very beginning, we have started with the research, then the steps of research, and then the data processing and analysis. This is the major part of our research methodology, that how to collect the data, how to process it, and how to analyze it. Already I have discussed with you all earlier that the data collection procedure must be very authenticated. From where we are collecting the data, it may be primary, it may be secondary, but all the sources must be authenticated and pre-tested. Otherwise, your analysis will become wrong. So describe demographics of the data. That means from where you want to collect your data, who are the responsive person, or which are the respective websites from where you can get the secondary data. So describe demographics of the data. This is the initial part. Then compare the behavior if applicable. It is only applicable in case of primary data collection, that where you can compare the behavior of the two respondents, more than two respondents together. So choose appropriate statistical techniques if applicable. Definitely it should be there, because nowadays we are more on the research oriented data or the statistical techniques tools we are using, because the data analysis part is very much important for all of us. And the theoretical papers, the era of theoretical papers are almost finished now. So look for patterns in data if applicable. So look for patterns means, suppose your area of study is from the year of 2015 to 2021. So you have to check the patterns of the data if it is applicable for your study from 15 to 21. That previously what you have collected for the year of 2015 and what you can collect in the year of 2020. Because of this pandemic, there is a huge problem in data collection period. So in this period of pandemic, we cannot get the authenticated data. That is also another big question for the data collection, for the researchers. So data processing and analysis definitely depends on the behavior of the respondents and the authenticated purpose and the authenticated resources. Now interpreting the results. Explaining and communicating data to the interested parties. How you can interpret your results? You have collected data. You have done your basic groundwork. Either it is primary or it is secondary. Already you have collected your data. Now you have to interpret the particular results. So explaining and communicating data to the interested parties. Who are the interested parties? Those who are the researchers. Now, these collections of data and the analysis of data, sometimes some research agencies are also doing during a time of a big project. So explaining and communicating data to the interested parties. In case of our own research work or our own PhD, you have to explain and communicate your own data, whatever you have collected. Discuss implications for the population of interest and future researcher. So you have to, at the end of your research, you have to discuss the implication of your particular research for the population of interest and future research. That means the students, those again who will study the particular research work, how come they will analyze your work and how come they will utilize your work as their review of literature. So explanation and communicating data is also very important. And the secondary part is discuss the implications of the to the populations. Now, if you are going for a certain research work, many people will not be get interested about your research. So those who are interested, they are the interested population for your research work, and you can explain it to them for the benefit of the researcher. Now, there are the second part, that is method of data collection. So initial part is covered, that what is research and how we can continue with our research work from the very basic till the end of the implication and the analysis. Now the methods of data collection. So initially we will discuss what is data or what is data sheet. Data is an existing information or knowledge represented or coded in some form suitable for better usage or processing. So data must be needed in day-to-day life. For the researcher, data is important, data collection is important, then the analysis of data is also very important for the research work. Then you can find the authenticated result. Data is a set of values, qualitative or quantitative. So data can be two types. It can be qualitative, it can be quantitative, but it is a set of values. You are getting not a single one, but you are getting a set of values. Now we will discuss about the quantitative versus qualitative data. What is quantitative data and what is qualitative data? So initially what we discussed, that we discussed what is data. And data is not a single value, it is the data set. And this data set is again subdivided into two parts. One is quantitative, another one is qualitative. For a researcher, these two types of data are needed for the research work. Quantitative data are anything that can be expressed as a number or quantified. It is quantified, that means it can be measurable. These data may be represented by ordinal interval or ratio scales and lend themselves to more statistical manipulation. So it is a measurable concept, quantitative data. Now, what is qualitative then? Then qualitative data is a categorical measurement expressed not in terms of numbers. So it's a theoretical measurement, but rather by means of a natural language or descriptions. In statistics, it is often used interchangeably with the categorical data. So if you want to go for your statistical implication of your research work, you definitely bank on the quantitative data rather than qualitative data. So quantitative data and qualitative data, both are important for our considerable research work. Now, what is the difference between this? A very simple example I have given. So it is qualitative and quantitative data. It can be gathered in some way. A person, a data unit is a person. If you think about a person, you can ask them two questions. How many children do you have? So it's a quantitative, then it will be two children. In which country were your children born? India. How much do you earn? Rupees 60,000 per month. What is your occupation? Teachers. So it is quantitative and qualitative, and both the data are required for your research analysis. So one is quantitative and another one is qualitative. So from a respondent, you can get qualitative data as well as quantitative data if you have a proper prepared questionnaire. Now, what is primary data and what is secondary data? The task of data collection begins after a research problem has been defined. You have completed your research design. You have already chalked out your plan. You know that the arena of your research, where the demography rise, so you can go for primary and secondary data. So what is primary data? Primary data and the secondary data, there are two options that you can get. The task of data collection is done. While deciding about the method of data collection to be used for the study, the researcher should keep in mind two types of data. One is primary, another one is secondary. So now, what is primary? Primary means face-to-face, or maybe the first-hand data you are using in your research process. And then the whatever you are gathering after that, that will be called as the secondary data. So we'll discuss first about the primary data. It is collected by the researchers. Like we, all of us, when we are going for a new project, when we are going for a new paper, we need to collect the data. If we think that the data should be on the basis of primary, so it will be called as a primary data collected by the researcher. So it is not based on any website. It is not based on any authenticated journal. It is the first-hand data collected by your own. Secondary data collected by someone else and have already been passed through the... please mute your microphone. So secondary data collected by someone else and have already been passed through the statistical process. And many of the researchers have already used that also. A researcher, as per requirement of study, may decide on use of primary data and the secondary data. Based on this pandemic, which started from the year 2019, we almost forced to use the secondary data of all the researchers or all the PhD scholars. They are faced to use this secondary data because we don't have any other option to go and collect the data from the direct researcher or from the field. We cannot get any data. So a researcher, as per requirement of the study, may decide on use of primary data, secondary data, or both. So as a researcher, you only finalize that which data set you want to use. Is it a primary one, direct from the correspondent, or is it a secondary one, or it is a mixed one? Both the primary data and the secondary data have their own pros and cons. That is definite, that how come you will go for which kind of data. The methods of collecting data mainly refers to collecting primary data, because nowadays secondary data are easily accessible by all of us. If you have the authenticated sources of NET and the websites, we know that how to collect the data from the secondary sources. As the secondary data are already available, we have to carefully choose the sources, relevancy of data, and reliability. Definitely from all the reliable sources, we are using these data as it is secondary. So that means the error can happen in the primary data analysis if it is not collected properly. And secondary data, the error can happen if you are getting the data from an unauthenticated sources. Sources of secondary data are existing literature, reports of professional agencies, department archives, internet, etc. While collecting secondary data, one has to follow legal procedures. What is the legal procedure? Suppose it is the PRAVIS database. So you have to go, either your organization or personally, you have to go and fulfill the requirement. Then you can go for the PRAVIS database. Same with the JSTOR also. From where we can get the reports of professional agencies, archives, etc., and existing literature, which are from the authenticated sources. Now, methods of collecting primary data. This is the important part, because getting primary data, it's important for a researcher. And there are different methods of this data collection procedure, that how to collect the primary data. There are several methods of collecting primary data, particularly in surveys and descriptive research. So we will discuss one by one. First one, through the observation method. Suppose you want to collect the data from a demography where the people, suppose you want to go for your work for the self-help group. So self-help group means, for the observation means, you have to go to their office for more than one day, maybe on a month, daily, regular basis, you have to go. You have to observe them that how they work. And you have to ask them. You have to ask them. So it is the direct interview or it is the primary data collection. You will prepare your questionnaire as per their need based or the schedule, or you can use the other methods for their direct conversation procedure. So that means observations and interview are very important for this primary data collection method. Now, first we'll discuss about what is observation. So one by one, we will discuss the different methods of data collection. So first one is observation. See what is happening. What I have told you that from the very beginning, if you want to go or observe for a particular research area now or your demography of your research work, you have to go there on basis of regular basis and you have to check that what is going on, the way they are doing their day-to-day regular basis of work and see what is happening, what is their using patterns, what is the layout of the organization. I have written here layout of city and rural areas, but it is actually the layout of the organization where you want to go for your research arena. Quality of housing, conditions of road, each and everything depicts the necessary condition of the residents there, conditions of the building, etc. So this is the direct observation which one researchers can go. Now, filtering observation. So filtering is another issue because we know that sometimes rumors are there. The world we are observing, what we take with our senses, so I have depicted in this way, mental processing and official observation. So whatever we have observed, we have to take it in our senses. Then our mental processing must be done. And from that, we can write our official observations. Suppose you have checked one self-help group office where 50 people are working together. So what we take with our senses, that what these 50 people are doing during a daytime, every day what they are doing, what is their process of work, nature of accounting. Then the mental processing is done. That they started their work with like this, then they prepared their product, then their accounting procedure is done and how it is sellable in the market. Then official observations are done and you can write in a descriptive way in a paragraph. So observation is helpful when we get the direct informations. That means you can go, you can check, you can gather the data. So it is a direct information trying to understand ongoing behavior of the organizing people. So those who are in the organization, you have to check that, or in the area, you have to check their personal behavior. There is physical evidence, products or outputs, then it can be observed. What these type of self-help groups, what they are making, what they are selling in the open market. So these all physical evidence, products or output, you can check. Need to provide alternative when other data collection is not feasible or inappropriate. So this is a method of data collection which was continued from the decades after decades. But after this pandemic, it is almost closed now. So for this all data analysis, if the situation will improve, then definitely the researchers can go for this observation, interviewers can go for their correspondence. So all these things. So types of observation. Now you have to go for different types of observation. Participatory and non-participatory. So what is participatory? When you are asking directly that what you are doing, what is your regular schedule, what work you prepared today, what is the pricing of the product, who made that pricing, all these are participatory. That means you are inquiring people. So it is a participatory research work. What is non-participatory? Maybe you unbiasedly you are sitting and watching and noting down that what is going on. So that is non-participatory, but you can gather the full data if you are staying there. Structured, semi-structured, and unstructured. When a researcher is completely dependent on his own questionnaires, that whatever he prepared, he or she prepared and then went for that researcher's interview. So it is a structured. Semi-structured means something is your mind and you haven't prepared any questionnaire, or maybe it is a half-done part. Unstructured, you don't know what you have to ask, but you went there. So it is an unstructured work, you cannot get the proper data. with a proper questionnaire, with a structured questionnaire, you can get maximum data from your own correspondents. Otherwise, one correspondent who is willingly give you answer today, maybe if you ask again and again the same thing or same pattern of thing, he or she will deny. So they will not even answer that whatever you are asking. Then controlled and uncontrolled data. Then if you are prepared with your proper questionnaire, proper data set, then it is a controlled one. And if you are not prepared with anything, then uncontrolled, whatever is your wish, you are asking, so you are not getting the authenticated picture. Advantages and disadvantages of observation. Subjective bias eliminated. When in a continuous basis, you are checking their behavior, their pattern after day by day, then bias will be eliminated because you know what is the groundwork they are doing. Researcher gets current information independent of respondents. But that means you are getting an unbiased opinion from your own eyes. So this is the most authenticated one. Disadvantages, many disadvantages are there. Expensive, time consuming, okay, and limited information, because whenever you are asking question, people may not will get you the full information. And unforeseen factors may influence observation. So unforeseen factors means when there is a political influence or there is a, some restriction instructed by the higher authority to them, they will not give you the proper answer. So some disadvantages are also there. But through your observation, you can get an unbiased data. Next one is interview. The interview method of collecting data involves presentation of oral verbal stimuli and reply in terms of oral verbal responses. If you are going to an illiterate person, then if you ask them the proper questionnaire, maybe they will not be able to answer properly. So in case of this, you have to go for this observation method. But when you are going to a respondent who is marginally educated and who can answer pretty well, then you can go for this interview method of collecting data. This method can be used through personal interview or maybe the telephonic interviews. Nowadays, sometimes it's a WhatsApp questionnaire filling up, sometimes it's a telephonic interview also through mail, through net we can utilize. Here also the problem is there, structured, semi-structured or unstructured interview. If you are properly ready with your questionnaire, with your question, with your objectives, with your opinions, then definitely you can get a structured data set. Next is interview types. There are different types of interview. Personal interview that I have already discussed. Interviewer asking question in a face-to-face contact to the other person. Maybe one person or maybe multiple person at a time. Direct personal investigation or indirect oral investigation. So as per your research area, as per your research work, you can simultaneously ask 20 people if they are sitting together also the same question one by one. If you think that no, it will be a confidential one, then you will allow each one to come separately, sit in front of you, and you can ask. Focused interview is meant to focus attention on the given experience of the respondent and its effects. So this is the point that I have discussed with you, that it will be a confidential one. When a person is sharing his or her opinion, experience of his own life or her own life, then it must be confidential. Clinical interview is concerned with both underlying feelings or motivation or with the course of individual life experience. So if it is individual life experience, if it is a sensitive issue, if it is against the society, you have to go for this personal interview method, but which must be confidential. Non-directive interview is that where the interviewer's function is simply to encourage the respondent to talk about the given topic with a bare minimum of direct questioning. So you can ask that after this Amphan, what happened? If you are going to Sundarbans or any area related near about Sundarbans, you can ask any one of them that give your experience, what happened after Amphan. So they will give you a descriptive way, a narrative one. So from this, you have to find out the necessary implication of his or her story. So this is also non-directive interview. You are not directing anyone. You don't have any question yet. You're only asking their experience and you are noting it down. Skill of interviewer, very much depending on the skill of interviewer. Easing respondents into the interview. So whoever is in front of you, you have to make the situation ease and you have to feel them comfortable in front of you. Then only they can give you the proper answer. Asking strategic questions. If you are writing in your questionnaire that what is your family income, people are generally don't want to disclose their income. So what you have to do, you have to give the different brackets that it is from 80,000 to 1 lakh, then 1 lakh like this. So each separate brackets are the strategic questions you need to prepare. Prompting and probing appropriately. And suppose if anybody stopped after your interview or after one question, they don't want to answer, you have to prompt them in an appropriate manner. You have to push them to get the correct answer. Keeping it moving. If the correspondent do not want to answer a question, please move on. Please move on. Because after 20 to 21 questions, you can easily guess the third question, what he was unwilling to answer. Winding it down when the time is right. So after a few questions, maybe they will feel much more comfortable and they will give the proper answer. So it entirely depends on the skill of interviewer that your correspondents are giving the proper answer or not. Then merits and demerits of the interview process. Merits, more in-depth information, personal information. You can get the accessibility, greater flexibility. You can stop, you can ask more, you can add on questions. If he or she is not comfortable, you can reduce it. Adaptation as per the respondents. That means if he or she is not comfortable, you reduce. If he or she is comfortable and willing to share his or her experience, then go for more. Demerits. Bias of the interviewer. That means according to your own perception, the data set can change. Time consuming. Yes, it is time consuming. It is expensive that you have to go there. You have to sit there. You have to spend your whole time. And then only you can get the answer. Yes, need expertise. You should have the proper skill of as an interviewer. Otherwise, you cannot get any data from any person. Next one. Basically, nowadays, we are depending upon this questionnaire method. A questionnaire is sent usually by post or through mail nowadays, through WhatsApp, concerned with a request to answer the question and return the questionnaire. We are using this questionnaire method nowadays frequently, where because it is instant, we don't have to go there. It's not time consuming. Through a WhatsApp chat, you can send it. If it's a group, then you can ask the 50 correspondents to answer, and you can get easily within 2 to 3 days, within a 7 days, you can get quick answer and a quick data set. A questionnaire consists of number of questions printed in a definite order. The order must be definite. Whenever you are preparing a questionnaire, that I will discuss now only, how to prepare a questionnaire that you can get the proper data from the person who is interested to fill up your questionnaire. The respondents have to answer the questions on their own. Definitely, when you are getting a questionnaire of 20 to 30 questions, so you are sitting alone or maybe you are sitting in the office and through the Google form, you are doing the you are giving the answer and help the researchers to get their data. So it is very much encouraging in nowadays that through Google form, you can circulate it quickly and easily. Steps in questionnaire construction. Preparation, constructing the first draft. Self-evaluation. That means that you have to think that if you are the correspondent, you will give the answer or not. Or you will ignore the question. So you have to ask yourself first. After compiling of your questionnaire, you have to ask yourself that if you are the correspondent, will you give the answer? External evaluation must be there. Revision, pretest or pilot study. Then again, second pretesting and preparing the final draft. So the questionnaire, preparing questionnaire is also a big task. If you have the proper questionnaire, then you can get the proper data set. Your analysis can be done. Then there will be no ambiguity at all. So questionnaire preparation is a very important and methodical one where your guide will help you a lot. Now, essentials of a good questionnaire. questionnaire should be short and simple. Day before yesterday, I received a questionnaire where 60 questions are there. So initially, it should not be like this. If you're going for a major study, then it is okay. Otherwise, you restrict it. So questionnaire should be short and simple, arranged in from simple to difficult. Simple questions must be at the beginning. Then the level of question will increase in a slightly difficult level. Personal and intimate questions should be left to the end. That I have told you that either it should be asked strategically or you have to ignore. Okay. Technical term and vague expression should be avoided, because the person, whoever is answering your questionnaire, he or she must not get the idea or any particular knowledge of that particular terminology. So you have to go for a very basic one. Question should be answered in yes or no or in multiple choice. Then options must be given, 4-5 options. Then the correspondent can answer easily. Control question to cross-check the information of the respondent. So if you are giving 30 questions in your questionnaire, you have to check that the questionnaire must be cross-checking from one question to another question. That suppose one question is in which professions you are there. So then the name of the office. So it can cross-verified and can be checked properly. Advantages of questionnaire, very, very important for you all. Lower cost, time saving. Preparation of a Google form will require only 3 to 4 minutes. Lower cost, it's time, it saves the time also. Accessibility to widespread respondents through mail, through WhatsApp, through your messenger, you can send the questionnaire very easily. No interviewer bias, because nobody will be sitting in front of you. Greater anonymity, yes. And respondent's own convenience is there. As per his or her timing, he will give the answer. Standard wordings and no variations. Suppose you are circulating 60 questionnaires, this 60 questionnaire must be the same type. Then only you can go for your authentic research work. Disadvantages of questionnaire can be used only for educated people. Yes, it is there. Because those who cannot read or write, they cannot answer. So if your study is based on rural area or for SHG, self-help group, loan division, financial inclusion, in that case, you have to go for a personal interview session. Sometimes different respondents interpreted questions differently. So that means the questions should be self-explanatory, that the person can read and understand. Questionnaires do not provide an opportunity to collect additional information, which can be possible through the personal data collection, that you know. That extra questions can be always added. But in case of questionnaire, it is not possible. Researchers are not sure whether the person to whom the questionnaire was mailed has himself answered the questions. So they do not know. Actually, sometimes we are getting the data from the person whom we know. Sometimes it is already in motion, circulated, and we are getting. So we are reluctant to answer. Many questions remain unanswered. If I don't want, I will answer only 15 questions out of 30. And then I will press the button and it will be submitted. So the research work is not yet completed. So this incomplete data set will not help the researcher anymore. The respondent can consult other person before filling up the questionnaire. Definitely, we can ask our friends that what we should write, what you are writing, I will also write the same thing. So then the purpose of research cannot compute the data set, cannot finalize the data with this. Now the schedule. What is schedules? Schedules like questionnaires contain a set of questions. Researcher enumerators appointed to collect data through the schedules. Schedules generally we need to hand over to a third party or the agencies which are going and collecting data. Enumerators go to the field, put questions to the respondents and fill the schedule. Enumerators need to be trained. Now who are the enumerators? Suppose I'm in a project of central government and I have employed for my data collection, 2 or 3 persons. Their only work is to collect the data, to go to the field to collect the data and then submit it to the concerned person. So in this case, enumerators, those who are going to the field, I have to teach them, I have to train them. So for a big research work or for a big project funding, generally all these enumerators get the lesson from the original researcher that how they should go fill up the schedule, how they should go to the primary primary data collection, or they should go to the field. Now, questionnaire versus schedule. This is the difference. We have talked about questionnaire, we have talked about schedule. So it is mailed, filled by respondents. It is direct contact, filled by researchers or enumerator. Economical, schedule is expensive. Non-response high, non-response low. If you are going for a personal interviews, you can catch hold of that people and you can get the answer. But if it is if it is through mail, through WhatsApp, you cannot catch hold of anyone. It's time consuming and schedule is time bound. Within this time limit, you have to finish 50 questionnaires. So you have to do that. Literate person only can go for this questionnaire, and no such precondition is there. That means literate, illiterate, anybody can fill up the schedule. Success depends on quality of questionnaires. Success depends on quality of enumerator. So enumerator means who is the midway, who is the bridge in between the researcher and the correspondence. And success depends on quality of questionnaires. Now, some other methods which we are using rarely. Variety card, postcard, size card sent to the customers and feedback collected through the asking questions. Generally, it happens for the consumer goods. Distributor or store audits are performed by manufacturer or distributor through salesmen, that how much it sold out, how much stock was there, is the people are interested for the product, are they buying the product. So this is all the secondary data collection. Pantry audits, from the observation of pantry of customers to know purchase habit of people. Questions may be asked at the time of audit only. Previously, what happened, these questionnaires or schedule, people are coming to your house and they knock and they ask that which brand of shampoo you are using, which one you want to buy in near future, what are the advantages, what you are using, what you want to buy for near future, what should be the price range of that. So this is the audit. That is the self audit. Previously happened, but nowadays it's reduced because the market research agencies are going directly to the stores and they are asking questions, and the questionnaires is also moving through net. Some other methods are also there. Consumer panels pantry audit approach on a regular basis. So a panel of consumer is created, and where a set of consumers are arranged to come and understanding to maintain detailed daily records. If you are going for a big bazaar, or if you are going for Spencer, if you check that sometimes the different from the different companies, many persons are appointed to the same in front of the basket or in front of the rack. Suppose you are going for a Saffola oil. So people from Saffola, they will instruct and they will guide you that what are the products they have newly launched. Basically, it happens with the newly launched product. So consumers panel pantry audit is generally done with this. Projective techniques developed by psychologists to use projections of respondents for inferring about underlying motives, urges, or intention. It happens in a very low-key manner. That is, suppose it's a very sensitive issue, what I have discussed with you all, that when I have discussed some sensitive issue with the single person, what is the underlying motive of that? So you have to ask a psychologist who can explain the intentions, what the people want to discuss with you all, what he asked, what you asked, what he or she answered, and what is the implication of that. Sometimes you have to take their help also. Use of mechanical devices are also there. That is picture camera, and you can use your mobile camera nowadays that you are taking a picture of the correspondent. It is also there. Then depth interview sessions are also there, when you can cross-check with your data collection, and you can ask any one of them from this sample, and you can ask them in depth the questionnaires, or you can ask them about the projective techniques and the indirect question for your sustainable research work. Content analysis, analyzing the contents of documentary material such as books, magazine, newspaper, that you can also use. Now the methods of data collection we have discussed a lot, but what else you should take? Selection of appropriate method of data collection. It depends on many other secondary factors. Nature, scope, and object of inquiry. where you want to go. If you want to produce your paper for the stock market, you definitely not go for the primary survey. You will go for secondary survey with the different data sheet. Now, availability of fund. If you have available fund for your research work, you can definitely go and directly ask them. So the direct questionnaire method definitely will follow. Availability of time also, degree of precision required. That is also very important. Before the collection of data, you need to think about all these points and then you have to suggest. Precautions in data collection. The data must be relevant to the research problem. It should be collected through formal or standardized research tools. So you know what are the standardized research tool, authenticated data sources. From there only you have to collect your data. The data should be such as this can be subjected to statistical treatment easily. So you are collecting the data, you are using your statistical analytical tools, and easily you can getting the results, then you can interpret. But if you have made certain questions here, which are not depicting your research values, then you cannot analyze. The data should have minimum measurement error. Now, the data must be tenable for the verification of the hypothesis. It should be collected through objective procedure. Whatever is your objective, you will collect data for that. Suppose your objective is to finalize the financial literacy and you are collecting the data from all other sources for all other questions, for all other ways and means, it is not required at all. The data should be accurate and precise. It should be reliable and valid. It should be complete in itself and also comprehensive in nature. So if you can collect the data sheet, it must be comprehensive in nature. Okay, so these are the different methods of data collection. Now I will discuss one more slide with you all. I know that timing is short, but I just want to discuss one more thing. Am I allowed, Antura? I just want to discuss one more thing.
Yes, ma'am, you can carry on.
Okay, just a minute. That will be also very helpful for the researcher. So I don't want to miss this opportunity. I want to share it. Is that visible, Antara?
No, ma'am, not yet.
Introduction to sampling, is it not visible?
No, ma'am, you have like stopped the sharing. Stop sharing, you just reshare it once again.
Is that visible, Antara?
Yes, ma'am, now it's visible.
Introduction to sampling. Okay, just a quick discussion of sampling, because I know that it is very much required for all the new and old researcher. So it's a quick brush up of the sampling. You will get the entire recording and I will send you the PPTs also, so it will be easier for you to understand. So concept of sampling, what is samples? Sampling may be defined as the selection of some part of an aggregate or totality. A part that you are choosing from a varied data set, you are choosing a part on the basis of which you can go for your judgment. Sampling involves any procedure that uses a small number of items. Suppose your data set is carrying 2 lakhs variables, but out of that, you are just extracting 2,500 variables. So this is called sample. In other words, a sample is a subset of a larger population. You know about the sampling, but I just need to brush it up because for all research work, the sampling is very much required and sometimes we forget. Need for sampling, it is used for a practice for a variety of reasons. It can save time and money. If you individually go and cross-check 2 lakh items, it will be difficult. So if you just pick up and choose 2,500 out of that whole measurement, it will be easier for you people to understand.
Your slides are not moving.
Again?
Yes, ma'am.
Don't know.
You just select the slide number. Yes, ma'am. Now it's fine.
But it's not the full screen, no? This is the only
difference. No, I'm not. It's not a full screen. Can you just make it a little bigger? Yes, ma'am.
Mm-hmm.
It's better.
That I have already discussed. Need for sampling, we are discussing. Sampling may enable more accurate measurement for a sample study generally conducted by trained and experienced investigator. That cannot be done for a fresh researcher. Cannot be done with a fresh researcher. It can be done who is already experienced in that field. So out of that 250,000 data, you can fetch 2,500 data sheet and you can go for that. Sampling frame. I just want to discuss with the sampling design. A sample design is a definite plan for obtaining a sample from the sampling frame. Out of this 2,500 data, what you want to do, that should be in your mind. It is determined before any data are collected. With a vision, with a mission, you have collected 2 lakhs data. Various sources, all authenticated, all these authentic data. But if you want to analyze this 2 lakh data, it will take 2 years of time only for data analysis and your research will go in vain because at that time the research will be over. Somebody else have already researched and already published a paper. So what you have to go, if you go for sampling design, you have to fetch a data set and with this authenticated data set, you can go for your analysis. Different methods of sampling. This is very, very important for all. Probability sampling, sample has a known probability of being selected, that either it will be chosen, either it will not be. Non-probability also, sample does not have known probability of being selected as in convenience or voluntary response survey. So this probability sampling and non-probability sampling both are very much interrelated to each other. Types of probability, simple. It is unrestricted. It is random. Any time you can go for that. It is a random sampling. Very easy. Now we can go for complex. Complex one, restricted one. Stratified random sampling, cluster is there. Systematic and convenience. Each one of them is important when you go for a research methodology workshop. So each one of them, just check one by one. Simple, random, unrestricted. It is least bias and offers the most generalizability. At times, it can be inefficient, expensive, because whatever is our choice, we are picking it up. A sampling procedure in which every element in the population has a known and equal chance. That means out of 100, anyone can be selected because it is random. There is no trait. You can easily pick any one of them. Now, systematic sampling. Systematic sampling is a sample size of small n. I have noted it. It is desired from a population containing the big n. That means a bigger number. We might sample one element from every n from that bigger n. So there is a systematic sampling. First, we randomly select one of the first n from out of big n. Then we can go for select every n out of the big n. So this method is more authentic or more authenticated than the random one. So suppose out of 100, you have selected the 9th one, then again, you will go for the 18th one. So it is going on like this order. So it is the systematic sampling. Now advantages and disadvantages, stratified random sampling. The population is first divided into groups. It is called strata, gender, age, race, location, industry. Then you pick up the data. Best results are obtained when the elements within each stratum are as much like as possible. That means the homogeneous group. So homogeneous means that homogeneity must be there. Maybe the gender homogeneity, maybe the age, maybe in the department, maybe the location, etc., etc. So stratified random sampling depending upon the homogeneity. Cluster. The population is first divided into separate group, which is called cluster. Now small scale is there, large clusters are also there. So you have to pick up only one cluster. A simple random sample of the cluster is then taken. Whichever is the easier one to pick, you will pick that same cluster. Advantages and disadvantages are also there. And the last one, not the least, that is a convenient sampling. it is a non-probable one. It is primarily with the convenience the researcher is asking. A professor conducting research might use student volunteer to constitute a sample. So as per my convenience, as per the researcher convenience, they are preparing a group, they are preparing a tool. Multi-stage samplings are there, that is different levels of sampling. First, we can use the random, then stratified like this. Now, how a large sample should be is a difficult one. So how come we will generalize the sample size? Sample size depends on the nature of the analysis to be performed, the desired precision of the estimates one wishes to achieve, the kind and number of comparisons that must be there. So depending upon that, we can classify, we can choose our sampling procedures. So sample, very hurriedly I have discussed, but I thought that it must be with the at the end of the lecture, because the sampling is very much needed for a research, for a researcher or those who want to go for a research study. Okay, thank you all. Thanks for patience hearing and so many net issues and everything where I have discussed within a 1 hour time whatever I can. So if you have any question, you can ask me or you can write it in Inchaspar. Thank you, Shubhashri. Thank you, Shubhashri ma'am. And if it is informative to all, then please collect this recording. And if you want any further suggestion for your research work or for anything, I'll write in chat box my mail ID. You can mail me there or you can contact with Sayad because I have a close contact with them. So I can reply to them also. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for giving such instructive presentation in this short span of time. I really felt that I was doing the lecture once again with you. I was so happy. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you. Any of the participants have any question? If you have any questions, please write in chat box. I'm writing my mail ID also. So if you need any instructions.
Yes, ma'am, kindly share your mail ID in the chat box. Everyone is asking.
Yes. Thank you all. Thanks for this, all this net issue that it's not visible initially, but somehow we have managed. Anyway, thank you all.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you, Sameer. Thank you, Shubhashri, ma'am.
As we have nearly come to the end of our today's session, I must mention our deepest sense of appreciation to Dr. Subrata Chattopadhyay. I may like to express our sincere thanks to Dr. Kya Dash Ghosh. We are grateful to Professor Aditi Day, ma'am, Principal Sri Shikshakan College, for supporting us in this, and Jyoti Dash, ma'am, for taking out her time and gracing this platform today. My heartfelt gratitude to Dr. Vishwajit Rai Choudhury for taking this initiative. With that, we have come to the end of the first day of this 5 days national level faculty development program. On behalf of my institution, I'm compelled to all the esteemed delegates who have joined us today. Hope you liked today's session. So one last time from the entire organizing committee of SIUR, we thank you for joining us today. Hope to see you all tomorrow. Good night.